came by today to see you. Oh, I had to let you know. If I knew the last time that I held you was the last time, I'd have held you and never let go. Oh, it's kept me awake nights wondering. I lie in the dark just asking why. I've always been told you won't be called home until it's your time. I guess heaven was me. Somebody just like you, brave enough to stand up for what you believe and follow it through. When I try to make it make sense in my mind, the only conclusion I come to is heaven was needing a hero like you. I remember the last time I saw you. Oh, you held your head up proud. I laughed inside when I saw how you were standing out in the crowd. You're such a part of who I am. Now that part will just be void. No matter how much I need you now, heaven needed you more. 'Cause our heaven was needing a hero, somebody just like you. To stand up for what you believe and follow it through. When I try to make it make sense in my mind, the only conclusion I come to is that heaven was near. Heaven was needing a hero.
Next week.
You'll be 2 minutes late.
And then we'll go back to green. You really can't. For ordinary days.
All right, you guys ready? Y'all ready? Good morning. Okay, Beth Ann is on a well-deserved weekend camping with her children today,
yes,
so
boss.
We'll have all pre-recorded stuff today. So if you'll stand, we'll start with Shout to the Lord.
Amen, and you can be seated. I don't know who it is. One of us is ringing loud, huh? Well, good morning. I want to welcome all of you here to our services of worship today. It's good to see all of you out. It's good to see some folks, some of our regulars back in church, having them here. It's just a great day for us to be worshiping, not only on this second Sunday of Pentecost, but on this Memorial Day weekend, when we remember and we celebrate the lives and the memories of those who laid such an extreme cost on the altar of freedom. We remember them and celebrate them today. Of course, you've already noticed Beth is not with us. Paul is filling in. We're looking forward to experiencing the magical tones of Paul Cedro during our service today. So, Paul, we appreciate you, buddy. Huh? You're going to try to stay awake? Oh, okay. All right. Maybe we're not going to experience the magical tones of Paul. Who knows? I do want to remind you that we have our attendance registration pads that are in the pews. They're the big books there. If you can complete those for us, we would appreciate that, especially if you're visiting with us or has some new contact information. We'd like to keep our contact information up to date because we've got a lot going on in this church, especially this past week. We had a lot we have experienced, and you're going to be hearing more about that in the coming few days. So make sure you get that information there with you. I hope you got your Memorial Day mints that we gave out. They are suitable for consumption during the sermon today. And someone asked me earlier, I don't know who it was. I'm not going to say who it was, but his initials are Jim Tate. Jim asked me earlier why I didn't invite adults to go have gummy bears after church. If you don't like the mints, you're welcome to go to my office and have some gummy bears. Will that work, Jim? Is that okay? Is that okay, Jim? Oh, okay. All right. I just want to make sure you're happy, okay? Make sure you're happy. That's the chairperson of our staff parish relations committee right there. We're trying to keep happy. But anyway, it's good to see all of you here. And we are going to be remembering those who gave their lives for our freedom. We're going to be doing so with some very special music in the coming few moments. But let's begin with a word of prayer. Almighty God, on this second day of Pentecost, on this Memorial Day weekend, you have given us so much to celebrate and so much to remember. So we just pray in these next few moments that the power of your Holy Spirit would dwell in our midst and bring these celebrations and these memories to its ultimate conclusion that will satisfy your will in our lives and in our church. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to begin today with a great, great hymn of our nation, America the Beautiful. It's on page 696 if you want to follow along in the hymnals, or the words will be on the screen. Let's stand together as we join in singing.
Thank you.
might say, be seated, but we can't sing this next song sitting down. Just can't do it. If tomorrow all the things were gone I'd worked for all my life, and I had to start again with just my children and my wife, I thank my lucky stars to be living here today, because the flag still stands for freedom and they can't take that away. Minnesota to the hills of Tennessee, across the plains of Texas, from sea to shining sea, from Detroit down to Houston and New York to LA, there's pride in every American heart, and it's time to stand and say,
man. We come now in this time of worship where we always turn to God in prayer and offer to God the concerns and the needs of not only ourselves but of others in our church family. We remember all of those today. We want to continue to remember Miss Botusa and Dave McClung, who continue under the care of hospice. We want to continue to remember Curtis Eden in our prayers as she undergoes her cancer treatment. We want to lift her up. Sharon Dry is now in rehab. She's out of ICU and doing her rehab work. Visited with her a couple of times this week, and each and every day she's making good progress. And so she wanted me to let you know that she can't wait to get back into her pew. It's right down here. And so, and she said, you know, anybody can sit in it right now, but when she gets back, that's her place. So she's looking forward. She's looking forward to that. So we remember her. We also want to remember Ravinder Gahar, okay. This is a good friend of Lauren Joseph. He is struggling from an eye disease that is now sweeping through India. Many people are getting it. Of course, you know they're having all these problems with COVID, and it's just a difficult time for the people of India. So we want to remember him, and and all of the folks there in our prayers. Are there any other prayer concerns that we have? If so, if you have somebody you want to remember, let's just lift those names up at this time. Well, with all of these in mind, let's turn to God now in prayer. Almighty God, in whom we live and move and have our being, we give you our thanks and our praise today for the gifts that you graciously bestow upon us. The gift of life, which you sustain at every moment through the breath of your Spirit. This beautiful creation, this family of faith, and the gift of abundant and eternal life made available through the life, death, and resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ. We thank you that through our baptism into Christ's death, we too can look forward with confidence to our own future resurrections. Because you are so gracious to us, enable us in return to live lives that are marked by gratitude. Enable us to give graciously to others, following Christ's example of love. Enable us to think less of ourselves and think of ourselves less often as we learn to put the lives of others ahead of our own. Bless us as a church family. Empower us, all of us who are your children, to be your ministers and your ambassadors in the world. On this Memorial Day weekend, we pause to honor the men and the women in uniform who have done all of these things we pray for today. They have done these things to the fullest extent, placing our own lives ahead of theirs. We hold them and their families in our hearts today for their example of courage, their example of selflessness, and the love we give you thanks for it all. We pray that you would protect the men and the women in uniform today whose lives are constantly on the line. We pray that you would protect them, and we hope for the day that their work becomes unnecessary when swords are beaten into plowshares and spears are beaten into pruning hooks. And we as a world will study war no more. Help us all in the midst of this Memorial Day weekend not to focus more on our barbecues, our get-togethers, and our mattress sales. Help us to focus more on the freedom that is ours because of the sacrifice of so many. We pray this in the name of the one Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you and with the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. And we pray in the spirit in which he taught us to pray when he prayed these words. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. At this time, we'd like to invite our ushers to come forward so that we might have the opportunity to worship God through our gifts, our tithes, and our offerings.
Feel free to join us on this next song if you'd like. Anytime the words are on the screen, you're free to join us. We'd love to have it.
Good morning. I'm going to sit on the front row from now on, right? This morning I'm reading from Acts 2, 1 through 8. Unless your memory lapses, I read this last week. So let's listen to the word of the Lord. When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place. And suddenly from the heaven, there came a sound like the rush of violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues as of fire appeared among them, and the tongues rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them ability. Now there were devout Jews from every nation under heaven living in Jerusalem. And this sound of the crowd gathering, and it was bewildered because each of them heard them speaking in their native language. Amazed and astonished, they asked, "Are not all of those who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear, each of us, in our own language, our own native language?" This is the word of the Lord for the people of this. Let's try that again. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Okay, your bulletin's going to say we're singing Evidence today, but we're not. I couldn't find it in a key I could sing it, so we're going to do I Know. You may have heard this one several times. Answer any questions, but you hear me when I speak. You don't keep my heart from breaking, but when it does, you weep with me. You're so close that I can feel you when I've lost the words to pray. And though my eyes have never seen you, seen enough to say, I know that you are good. I know that you are kind. I know that you are so much more than what I leave behind. I know that I am loved. I know that even in the fire to live is Christ, to die is gain. I know that you are good. I don't understand the sorrow that you calm within the storm. Sometimes this weight is overwhelming. In my darkest day, from my deepest pain, through it all my heart chose to sing your praise. On my darkest day, from my deepest pain, my darkest day, from my deepest pain.
Thank you, Paul, and our choir. Would you join with me now in a spirit of prayer? Oh, Lord, we pray that the Holy Spirit would break in like a mighty wind and open us up again to your message for our lives today. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. You know, we're now a United Methodist Church, but that wasn't always the case, was it? It was back in, when was it, 1996? Was that the year that the Presbyterian Church merged with the Methodist Church? 06.
No. 8 years ago. What is
it? Okay, 21 minus 8, carry your 2, divide by 3. I don't know. Anyway, all right. It used to be the Presbyterians and the Methodists. And then this church merged to become a United Methodist Church. Now, how many of us here were Methodist when this took place? And how many of us here were Presbyterians when this took place? Okay, we've got the Methodists covered. And we've got the Presbyterians covered. Let's just add the Baptist to this story. Okay. Oh, we got a Baptist here? Okay, we got everybody represented. We want to add the Baptist in there because they're strange too. All right, they're strange too, okay? Every Wednesday, a Methodist preacher and a Presbyterian preacher and a Baptist preacher, they went to lunch. They went to lunch together every Wednesday. And one Wednesday when they were coming back from lunch, they ran into this traffic jam. Traffic wasn't moving at all. So they were sitting there when this police officer walked by their car. And the Methodist preacher who was driving rolled his window down. And he said, "Officer, what's going on? Why is the traffic stopped?" And the officer said, "Well, we have a man on the bridge up ahead and he's threatening to jump." And so the Methodist preacher said, "Well, we're three preachers. Is there anything we can do to help? Would you like us to go talk to him?" And the officer said, "Well, sure, we've been talking with him for 2 or 3 hours and we've gotten nowhere. Maybe you three preachers can get somewhere with him." And so they got out of the car and they walked up to the bridge and they approached the man slowly. He stood there on the edge of the bridge and the Methodist preacher asked him, he said, "Son, why are you doing this? Why are you doing this?" And he said, "I don't have anything else to live for." So the Methodist preacher said, "Well, do you believe in God?" And the young man said, "Yes, I believe in God." And so the Baptist preacher asked him, said, "Well, are you Buddhist or Muslim or Christian or what?" And the man said, "Oh, I'm Christian. I believe in Jesus Christ." The Presbyterian minister asked him, said, "Well, are you Presbyterian?" And the young man said, "No." The Methodist preacher asked him, "Are you Methodist?" He said, "No." And the Baptist preacher asked him, "Are you Baptist?" And he said, "No." So one of them asked him, said, "Well, then what are you?" He said, "I'm Pentecostal." He said, "I'm Pentecostal." And all three of the preachers, the Methodist preacher, the Baptist preacher, and the Presbyterian preacher, they all looked at each other and said, "You're Pentecostal?" He said, "Yes, I'm Pentecostal." So they all said, "Well, then we can't do anything for you." And they pushed him off the bridge. That's not right. Yeah, it's not right. You know, it's already been mentioned here today that we have read the same scripture passage for our worship service today as we read last week on Pentecost Sunday. And no, your preacher has not lost his mind. Okay, I've not lost my mind. Okay, what does that mean, Cindy? All right. What were you before we merged? Huh? Okay. Anyway, I haven't lost my mind, contrary to what my wife says, okay? I chose this passage for a reason, because this is the second Sunday of Pentecost. Pentecost is not just a one-day celebration in the church. This is the second Sunday of Pentecost. Now, next Sunday, according to the Christian calendar, we'll go back to what we call ordinary time. But today is a day for us to continue to celebrate Pentecost. It is the second Sunday of Pentecost. And I chose that passage to read again to remind us that we are still celebrating that day when the church was born. And on this second Sunday of Pentecost, it's a good time for us to ask ourselves, are we Pentecostal? Are we Pentecostal? And I'm not talking about the Pentecostal religion. I'm not talking about speaking in tongues and jumping over pews and not wearing any makeup and killing chickens during worship and all that kind of stuff. Okay? I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about the spiritual side of Pentecost. Are we Pentecostal? Are we Pentecostal? It's a good question for us to think about on this second Sunday of Pentecost. And what does it mean to be Pentecostal? And again, not about the religion, but about the spiritual side of that. What does it mean to be Pentecostal? How do we know what it means to be Pentecostal? Well, Luke, in this writing of Acts, as he records that first day of Pentecost, he gives us some clues as to how to answer that question. He helps us answer that question by telling the stories of those first disciples. And in reading the story of what went on with those first disciples, we can start to understand what it means to be Pentecostal. Those disciples on that day of Pentecost, they became Pentecostal. They became Pentecostal for two reasons. Number one, they became Pentecostal because they were all together in one place. Luke writes, they were all together in one place. They became Pentecostal because they were all together. In his book, Gifts of the Spirit, I used to have a copy of it in my library. When I retired, I got rid of a lot of my library, okay, because I'm strange, according to my wife, and we didn't have room to put all those books that I had. So anyway, I gave them away to some people and all. But in his book, Gifts of the Spirit, Leslie Flynn was talking about how the Holy Spirit works within the context of a congregation. And he wrote these words. He wrote these words. The time had come for the carpenter's tools to hold their annual conference. Mr. Hammer immediately stood up and volunteered to preside over the proceedings. All of the other tools disagreed. For Mr. Hammer was always trying to pound and drive home his own way of thinking. Mr. Hammer said, well, who's going to do it then? Dare we ask Mrs. Screwdriver? You never know which direction she's going to turn. Dare we trust Brother Plain? His work is always on the surface and never has any depth. And then there's Sister Tape Measure. Do we want someone who's always measuring the work of the rest of us and trying to tell us who is right and who is wrong? Mr. Saul won't work because he's always cutting things down. And neither will Brother Sandpaper because he's just too abrasive. In the midst of the argument, the master carpenter walked in. The master carpenter placed each of the tools in his tool belt, and he started to work. All of the tools found their way into the master carpenter's hand, and with each of their unique gifts, the master carpenter used them to build a beautiful new pulpit. When the work was finally completed, all of the tools were ready to celebrate their accomplishment at the hands of the master carpenter. Until Brother Level jumped up onto the pulpit and said, this is no good. Our new pulpit is tilted too far to the left. Folks, The disciples became Pentecostal because they were all together in one place. And it wasn't just that they were together physically. They were all together in their commitment to use their unique gifts in order to proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ. All of these disciples were different. They were different from each other. They had different likes and dislikes. They had different ideas. They had different gifts, different talents, and different abilities. But they were all together in bringing what they had to offer. They were all together in bringing it together in order to proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ. Those disciples were Pentecostal because they were all together in the same place with their gifts and with their abilities. And they became Pentecostal on that day of Pentecost because they trusted the Holy Spirit. They trusted in the Holy Spirit, and they went where the Holy Spirit led them to do what the Holy Spirit wanted them to do. You know, in most Methodist churches, I know it's always been this way when I was a pastor. Of course, I still am a pastor, but I mean, you know, when I had confirmation classes, and we'll have one soon, I'm sure. Okay, we'll have some people ready for that. But in the Methodist church, usually on Confirmation Sunday, when all of these young people make their affirmations of faith and they are confirmed into the full membership of the church, on Confirmation Sundays, in almost all Methodist churches, you hear the Apostles' Creed. The Apostles' Creed is one of the rich traditions of the confirmation service in the United Methodist Church. In most United Methodist churches, you hear that on Confirmation Sunday. Well, at First United Methodist Church in Macon, Georgia, they hear the Apostles' Creed on Confirmation Sunday, but they hear it in a unique way, in a very different way. For the last few years, what they've done is instead of having the congregation stand and say the Apostles' Creed, they've had the confirmands do it. And they do it in a very different way. Each confirmand is assigned a certain part of the Apostles' Creed. And when the time comes for that person to read that part, that person steps forward and says their part of the Apostles' Creed. Well, 2 years ago, on their confirmation Sunday, it came time to hear the Apostles' Creed, and all the confirmands got up there, and they all had their parts memorized. And when it came time for the Apostles' Creed, the first confirmand stepped forward and said, "We believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth," and he stepped back into line. And then the next confirmand stood forward and said his line, "And we believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our God," and stepped back. Okay, and this went on down the line, time after time, and every one of the confirmants were saying their part. And then it came time for the part that says, "We believe in the Holy Spirit." And when it came time for the confirmant to say, "We believe in the Holy Spirit," there was silence. There was silence. And everybody was looking around wondering, why aren't we hearing the next part? And they realized for the first time that the young man who was supposed to say, "We believe in the Holy Spirit," he wasn't there. He was absent. And nobody had realized it until that point, according to their preacher. Well, this young lady who was a confirmand, she realized what was going on. So she saved the day. She stepped forward and she said, "Folks, I'm sorry, but today the one who believes in the Holy Spirit isn't here." Just not here. You know, there are a lot of folks who think, we Methodists, that we don't believe in the Holy Spirit. And that's not true. That's not true at all. We believe firmly in the Holy Spirit. And we believe firmly in the power of the Holy Spirit. You hear it all, it runs all throughout our doctrine and our theology and our practice. We Methodists, we believe firmly in the Holy Spirit. The problem with us Methodists is this. Yeah, we love to talk about the Holy Spirit, and we believe in the Holy Spirit, but not too much. Not too much. Got to be a little careful there with that Holy Spirit stuff. I mean, we love to hear a good amen or a hallelujah in worship on Sunday mornings, but not too much. Not too much. We love to praise the Lord, but not too much. Not too much. We love to pray for the Holy Spirit to guide and direct us in life and use us in whatever way the Holy Spirit wants to use us, but not too much. Not too much. We want to follow the guidance of the Holy Spirit. We say we want to do what the Holy Spirit is telling us to do, and we want to go and do it where the Holy Spirit is leading us. As long as the Holy Spirit doesn't lead us too much out of our nice, safe, cozy little places. The disciples became Pentecostal on that day of Pentecost because they trusted in the Holy Spirit. They took that risk and they went where the Holy Spirit was telling them to go, and they did what the Holy Spirit was telling them to do, even though it led them out of their nice, safe, comfortable little place. Friends, on that day of Pentecost, the day we continue to celebrate today, we celebrate today what made those disciples of that first Pentecost. We celebrate what made them Pentecostal. What made them Pentecostal had nothing to do with religion. Because if you remember, I told you 2 or 3 weeks ago, there's a big difference between religion and faith. They became Pentecostal that day because they were all together in one place. They were all together in allowing God to use their individual gifts and their individual abilities to proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ. And they became Pentecostal that day because they trusted in the Holy Spirit and they believed in the Holy Spirit. They went where the Holy Spirit told them to go, and they did what the Holy Spirit told them to do, even though it was at a huge risk. Friends, are we today, the disciples of today, are we willing to come together and each of us use our special and unique abilities? Are we willing to come together in the same place and proclaim that gospel of Jesus Christ? Are we willing to trust the Holy Spirit enough and believe in the Holy Spirit enough to go where the Holy Spirit is guiding us, to do what the Holy Spirit is telling us to do, regardless if it fits in our personal agendas or takes us out of our nice, safe, cozy little place? Are we willing to do that? Are we willing, the disciples of the day, are we willing to become Pentecostal? With that question in mind, let's turn to God now in prayer. Almighty God, on this day, as we continue to celebrate the second Sunday of Pentecost, we would pray that you would help us to become more Pentecostal. We pray that you would help us to continue to come together as a family of faith in new ways, bringing our own gifts, our own abilities together so that we can better proclaim your gospel. We pray that you would help us to trust your Holy Spirit, to go where your Holy Spirit is leading us, to do what your Holy Spirit is asking us to do. Today, help us. Help us to recommit ourselves to becoming Pentecostal disciples. We pray this in your name. Amen. Our closing hymn is hymn number 513. It's Christ Arise. And as we sing this hymn, if you might be here today and you would like to affirm your faith in Jesus Christ, become a Christian, we want to invite you to come forward as we sing. If you're here today and would like to unite with this church by transferring your membership from another congregation, we invite you to come forward as we sing. And in whatever way God's Spirit might be leading you to recommit to becoming a little more Pentecostal, in whatever way God's Spirit is asking you to respond to that, I ask you to do so. As we stand together now, as we sing our closing hymn, Soldiers of Christ, Arise.
Soldiers of Christ, arise and put your armor on. Strong in the strength which God supplies in His eternal Son. Strong in the Lord of hosts and in His mighty power.
You know, ordinarily, I pick the opening hymn and the closing hymn, but Paul chose the closing hymn today, and that was pretty good. You did a good job.
I couldn't sing yours.
It's a what now?
I couldn't sing the one.
Oh, you couldn't sing the one I chose. Oh, okay. Well, now we know the truth. Now we know the truth. Folks, on this Memorial Day weekend, I hope that all of you are safe, that you enjoy the time you have with family and friends. But let's not make that the priority. Let's remember that good men and good women fought and died so that we could do what we do here today. Worship freely. And let us also remember that the Holy Spirit has a lot of things for us to do. And in the season of Pentecost, we're not Methodist or Presbyterian or Baptist or anything like that. We are Pentecostal disciples. We go where the Spirit leads us. We're called to do what the Spirit is asking us to do. We're called to bring together all of our different gifts. And looking around this room right now and knowing some of the gifts that you possess, boy, if we bring this together in big ways, who knows what we can achieve as a church for the kingdom of God. So to you, my brothers and my sisters in Christ, go in peace. Sin no more. Love God and serve God's people. Amen.